Amir, Kartidane, Kardigil, Ispil Div, Mustafal Tarov, Pigadaka, Erno Kaz, Fishin Tishuk. You're all very welcome here to this our 150th anniversary of the Fenian Rebellion. Men who risked their lives in the name of Ireland. Last year has been one of commemoration and celebration of the events of 1916. It has restarted the ideas of the Irish nation and the part played by those who were prepared to give their lives to their country. The Easter Rising did not materialise out of thin air. A consistent theme of the second millennium was the wish of the Irish people to derive a self-determination and to express this in a nation state through self-rule and expression. Ireland's fighting spirit has never been entirely subdued, even though it lived in the shadow of a very powerful neighbour. The reconquest of Ireland in the 16th and 17th centuries, culminating in the Wilmot Wars of 1688-1691, had destroyed the Gaelic Armour, and the penal laws of the 18th century were designed to establish a new hegemony of an aristocracy that looked towards England. Still, the spirit of a national identity survived. The Republican tradition of Wolfe Tone and Robert Emmet believed that only through the force of arms would England concede Irish independence. Danny O'Connell and later Charles Stuart Parnell adopted constitutional and parliamentary methods with the passion of his admiral. Ireland suffered greatly in the United Irish Rebellion in 1798, but the sacrifices of Wolfe Tone and Robert Emmet, both Protestants, have inspired Irish Republicans ever since. The young Irelanders of 1848 did not achieve much in the military sense, but they kept the ideal of freedom for the Irish nation alive. Thomas Francis Marr brought the tricolour of green, white and orange back with him from France, and hung it proudly on the man in Waterford in 1848. William Smith O'Brien, in defying his class, played an honourable role in the movement and displayed notable bravery at the siege in Ballingarry. For his role, he was transported to Van Diemen's Land. Among those who took part in the 1848 rebellion were James Stephens and Thomas Clark Luby, who founded the Irish Republican Brotherhood on the 17th of March 1858. About the same time, two other 1848 men, Michael Donnelly and John O'Mahony, founded the Fenian Brotherhood in America. These two organizations joined forces to form what became known as the Fenian Movement, whose aim was to establish Ireland's independence by force of arms. Henceforth, the American connection was to be very important and ever present on the side of Ireland's freedom. The Great Famine was the single greatest disaster that befell the Irish nation, and America provided a home for up to a million of our compatriots. Many of these have great bitterness towards England for being forced from their homeland, and they carry this with them to the New World. The kindest comment that could be made of the British government in their handling of the famine was one of gross incompetence. The American Civil War had a large number of Irish combatants, many of whom were sympathetic to Fenian ideals. It is in this context that the Fenian campaign was undertaken in Canada, Britain and Ireland. The Ardagh Fenians. The IRB was a secret society. It had been set up with the aim of minimising the risk of informers. Its basic structure was the circle, which covered the local area. Its leader was the head of the circle, and the ordinary members did not know or were not in contact with members from other circles. The head of the circle in Ardagh was William Upton, who lived in the village near the barracks. Drilling of the volunteers took place in various locations around Ardagh and the old men. They had a number of rifles, but the main weapon for the vast bulk of men was the pike. These were made in the local forges of Daniel Quinlevin and Michael Adams. The IRB sent Captain John Murray to execute the attack in the barracks in Ardagh. The master plan of the Fenians, if it could be described as such, was for an uprising to take place on the 5th of March 1867 all over the country to show off the shackles of oppression. As it turned out, very few Assyrians took action, and in overall terms, its impact was minimal. Captain Murray was able to call on perhaps 40 or 50 volunteers in Ardagh. The aim was to force the surrender of the constables of the barracks before proceeding on to Rakeen to secure their arms. The barrack was defended by Captain Forsyth of Constable Forsyth and four sub-constables, all Irishmen. The attack commenced on Shrove Tuesday, March 8th, around 11 p.m. with shots directed at the windows of the barracks under cover of blackness. The constables were awoken from their slumbers by the sound of gunfire. They had retreated to their sleeping quarters upstairs. The rebels succeeded in ramming the front door and had gained access to the ground floor. The dying embers of the coal fire threw some light on the volunteers. Meanwhile, the constables had gathered on the landing above the stairs. Captain Murray called on the constables to surrender in the name of the House Republic and said they would not do so. At that point, Stephen Ambrose, still about 19 years old, and armed with a hatchet, proceeded to climb the stairs, calling out on the constables to surrender. After a couple of shots, a shot rang out. Stephen was hit in the arm and it caused a sudden panic among the volunteers. Stephen was taken out to the yard, and when he came around, he volunteered to have another go. The rebels also had a storm of hay with them and could have set the barracks on fire. However, Captain Murray decided against this course of action and instead ordered that the volunteers disperse. That night there was a heavy snowfall and many of those involved, mostly young men of the area, went into hiding. The Ambrose brothers, Stephen and Bob, went to nurses of Palestine and stayed for some time on islands in the River Shannon. Thereafter, Stephen made his way to America, as did a number of others. The attack itself lasted no more than half an hour, and besides Stephen Ambrose, another volunteer was shot in what was an incident of friendly fire. No constable was shot, but some did suffer minor injuries as a result of flying glass. The following morning revealed the extensive damage suffered by the barracks. One of the first in the scenes was able to remind the resident magistrate, and he was horrified with what he saw. He was anxious to calm the situation and put down the rebellion. Over the following couple of weeks, the police round up many of those who took part in the attack. In all, 26 men were brought into jail or trial. Of these, 12 were charged with high treason. Despite the seriousness of the charges, they were all released by July 1867, having spent 3 or 4 months in jail. One of the reasons for their release was that the harvest was imminent, and the same Edward O'Brien, who had been anxious to extinguish the rebellion, was now interceding on their behalf. He realized that many of their families needed income with these young men were there at harvest time. The youngest rebel was Robert Ambrose, who was just 16 years old. He was later captured and appeared before the local magistrate, Robert John T. Waller of Castletown, on the 4th of November 1867. When Waller asked the constable what he was charged with, Constable replied, "The boy was a Fenian." How old he was, and on learning that he had been 16 years of age, he replied, "Well, God help Ireland, it was only boys like this that can be found to fight for it." And he dismissed the charges. He showed that even those in authority could be human after all. Robert went on to study for the priesthood and was ordained in 1880 and became known as Father Bob to his family and friends. Now in Ardagh School there's a list of names detailing the people who took part in the rebellion, which Mary will read down at the graveyard. Well, one of the monikers down at the bottom was, "God bless the clay who arrest the villains of our land." Now these were mostly young men. whether you consider them brave or foolish is another matter, but they did play their part in keeping the ideal of an Irish Republic alive. On a broader front, even though the Fenian campaign of the 1860s failed in its primary purpose, the IRB survived and kept steadfast its goals. O'Donovan Ross in Ireland and John Devine in America, as leader of Clanmaghiel, all set an Irish family on the prize of Irish freedom. And so it passed along to Tom Clark and later Michael Collins to fulfill the IRB's ambitions. The link is there to what we have achieved today. We salute those men of 150 years ago who risked their lives in the cause of Irish freedom. Thank you.